So guys, tell me, have you all joined? Is there anything anybody else needs to join? Hi Rajita, hi Usman.
Hi sir.
Hi Chandra.
Hi sir.
Anu and Shilpa are yet to join, right? Okay, meanwhile, tell me how many of you have practiced ELB? Rashant seems to be practiced because he just shared some screenshots with me and then discussed few doubts. Rashant is fine. I'll just come one by one. According to the list, I'm able to see here. Chandra, what about you? Could you able to, you know, practice ELB? Yes? Guys, you need to speak and drop your inputs because this is really very important, practicing ELB and the problems you face with that. Okay. Any doubt, Chandra, any doubt you had while creating ELB? Did you test whether it is working or not? No, in the sense you don't have any doubt or you didn't get any issues? No doubt, that's good, that's good. So what about you, Rajita? Did you practice?
Yes, I practice, I started, but there were some network issues and I couldn't do it. Probably I'll just finish it tomorrow.
So you're going to practice it tomorrow. How about volumes? Creating volumes and extending that?
Yeah. Yes, the volumes are fine and the load data is also fine.
Okay, have you tried launching an instance with the bash script?
No sir, like I didn't have that time to launch because there were some network issues because I was traveling from my place to another place. So there was some problem with my network, so I couldn't.
But please make sure you practice today.
Okay. Yes, I'll just practice today and let you know tomorrow if I do have any doubts.
Okay, fine. Chandra and Prashant, have you practiced about volumes, eBay storage and launching an instance? Okay, good. Sai, what about you?
Just before the class, I did a load balancer. I think it's my network problem. When it's not coming in the load balancer, it's stealing out of service. Okay. I mean, we don't have a Wi-Fi here, so we are using hotspot. So it's still loading and loading away. So tomorrow I'll be going to the office, so I can tell like it's coming or not. That's the problem.
Okay, Srikant, what about you? Did you practice? Okay. ELB, volumes and all, everything? Or is there anything that you need to practice still? Yes, Srikant.
Hello? I practice it.
Can you see the yesterday class video? Yesterday class video, sir.
Yeah, I've already shared that.
No, sir, it's not came.
Did you get the access to AWS folder? The last,
yes, sir,
last email I sent. That is actually the folder I gave the permission with, and in the same folder I have uploaded yesterday's video also.
Okay sir, okay.
Okay. I'm not going to send an email every day, but the folder's permission is provided to you, and in that folder every day's video will be uploaded. So you go check the same old folder every day for your videos and all. Okay? So So you have practiced all the tasks, all the things, whatever we have discussed so far, volumes, launching an instance, with script, without script, creating web server onto it, and then ELB, everything you have done, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. What about Usman? Usman seems to be out. Any problem with the network? So now, okay, we are just about to, you know, discuss about autoscaling. Srikanth is offline. Guys, are you having any network issues? You guys are dropping out and then coming in. So what do we do today? Today's session will be little longer than usual. So please have to spare for some time, because we need to understand autoscaling, have to perform lab. Okay, we will be understanding autoscaling while we perform lab simultaneously. And not only that, we also have to check how an instance is launched by an autoscaling which is ready for our live production. Okay, so for that, what we have to do is, it's not only that we write a user script, okay, we just have a bash script updated in the user data while we launch an instance, but it is also that we need to create a web page. So how do we create web page without logging into the instance? So that we need to check with. And to do that, you know, to create web pages without logging into your instance, your server, okay, what we have to do is we ourselves have to create some HTML pages and keep them in the storage, which can be accessed by these EC2 instances with a script written into it while it is launching. Okay, so directly there should be a communication or a connection established with respect to that. The instance can, you know, correlate or communicate with that, or access, get the access of that index or HTML pages, which needs to be, you know, uploaded into this instance, so that whenever we wanted to access that website, we should be able to access. And whenever autoscaling spin up the instances, okay, autoscaling spin up the instances, it should spin an instance which can be readily used for our live production without our intervention, without we logging into that instance and then make things ready for it. Okay, so to do that, what we have to understand is establishing a connection between, okay, the storage and the instance. So for that, we need to have a little script, and not only script, we also have to create some storage. So for that, we will go to S3 bucket. Bucket is nothing but, understand, it is a container. Okay, it is a container for our storage, so that we can put any of our files or folders into that container, which is dedicatedly assigned for us, and we, whatever the way we prepare it. So I'll quickly show you these things, then we will go understand autoscaling. But before that, I wanted to tell you something. Every day, whatever the topic we discuss, so consider this is an assignment to you guys, whether I specifically point you every day or not, whatever the topic we discuss, that particular topic's lab to be performed by you guys, and I wanted your screenshots to be shared in our WhatsApp group, so that I'll understand, okay, you guys have practiced, and in case if there is any doubt, every day, you know, in the beginning of our session, while everybody log into this our meeting, join into the meeting, we can discuss our doubts, and then can start our classes once all are in. Seems to be Shilpa has just joined. Shilpa, have you practiced ELB volumes and all? No. Yes, you have any doubt? Are you clear with all the topics? say yes or no. Okay, clear. That's fine. That's fantastic. So you can't have any issues with your network. So remember, guys, so whatever the topic we discuss, I want you to perform that particular topic's lab every day, the same day, and wanted you guys to update your screenshots in the WhatsApp so that I confirm myself that you have practiced something, you could understand, and you could be, you have some hands-on experience about what we have you know, discussed. And any doubt, you can directly ask me over WhatsApp, and whenever you are practicing, whatever the doubt you get, I almost give you you know, a response as quick as possible, or you can also directly discuss in the class. Okay, so let's go and then do something quickly. I'm going to launch an instance directly. Okay, so we have to check the user's metadata. There is a simple silly thing which I have missed out, so that we could not get the metadata, and don't worry about this. This is just, you know, the naming conventions have changed, so that's why this, you know, notification has come. Quickly launching an instance. So this is where IAMrole. Okay, but let's see. I'll delete this. So I'm just taking this as a temporary server. Your so instance is launching. There are so many things we are going to do today. So I'll be little quick, which we already have understood, which we already have discussed. If you think that I'm going faster or you're not able to catch anything or get anything, you just stop me, interrupt me in between, and then get it clarified. What I'll do, I'll just go create a role here. What is the purpose of this role, we will understand. Okay, so S3 full access, which is already created. This is what the role is needed. So Amazon S3 full access, the policy is attached. Not to worry about these things. IAM, we have a separate class. We will understand everything in detail, how to create and what is what in this. So the role is, for now, understand what's role. Role is a thing which is created in IAM with certain permissions. The permissions are always provided by the policy attached to it. So for this role, the name of this role is S3 full access, and for that role we have attached a policy which says Amazon S3 full access. So anything which has this role attached to can access all the S3 buckets or S3 storage without having any issues. So that's what this role you know, is used for. So that's what we have discussed initially, right? We will be writing a script in the user data, and before that we create some web pages. Those web pages are kept in the storage, S3 storage, and there should be a communication or authentication established in between instances which we create and the storage. So how do we establish this authentication? That is possible by these roles. So the instances when attached with these role will get the authentication or will get the permissions to access the S3 storage. And what do? We create those web pages like index.html and healthcheck.html, these two web pages for now, for our lab purpose, for our demo purpose, or for our discussion, we keep these two files in, you know, HTML files in S3 storage, and this script pulls those files to the instance and load those two pages in Apache's root directory, so that without our intervention, without we logging to that instance and create these web pages manually by ourselves, we will be having these things readymadely loaded into that. So in this case, in our general example purpose, we are having only two web pages, like index.html and healthcheck.html. But in real time, you know what we do when it is a website, all the web pages related to that website are kept in the storage S3 bucket. From there, we pull all those things and dump into our instance. So our instance will be ready for our production with that. So the policy, what policy says, this is what the policy is. The version, when it is created, the date of that policy created, and statement, from here it starts. This is a small script. You don't need to, you know, worry anything about this. Okay, we will understand about policies and the script and all later on in IAM section. So what this says, effect allow, which means it will allow, the policy says, okay, you can allow to access, you know, the S3 storage. I mean, what is that to be allowed? The action is S3. The star mark says everything, resource is also everything. So people can access all the substances in an S3 bucket, and resource is also everything. Everybody who has this role attached with can access directly. So that's what this role is. Now we already have a role created. The same role we will go and do. And before that, what I'll do, I'll just go create some storage. Okay. The storage, to create the storage, okay, even about this creating storage also, understand what I'm showing it today. Only for so much you understand. Rest, we will discuss everything in detailed and topic by topic, point by point in S3 section separately. So what I said, bucket, we always create buckets in S3 storage. A bucket is nothing but it's a container to store all our files and folders into that. So go create a bucket. Okay. So while we create a bucket, the bucket name should be unique. It's because when we are trying to access, these are not only the, you know, account specific. Okay, they are of course region based, but can be accessed, the files and folders into this are, can be accessed by people. One sec, give me a second. Sorry for the interruption. Yeah, so things can be accessed over internet, just like your Google Drive. You know, your Google Drive can be identified with your email ID. Imagine if there are two email IDs having same, you know, mail ID. There are two people having same email ID, and when those two people keep their personal data into their Google Drive, okay, what happens when they are trying to access over internet from some other thing, from some other location? Which account these requests to be routed? So there will be a little confusion created into that. Just because of that, in order to avoid such confusion, the bucket names should be unique, because these things are the files or folders or the data loaded into these buckets will be accessed by, I mean, accessed over internet. So the names should be unique. So what I'll do, I'll now name this as my web data 145, something like that, randomly I've named, and they should not be, all the names should be the combination of numbers and lowercase letters, only lowercase, and there should not be any special characters in the namespace, names given to the bucket. So we are giving, and the region, in which region you wanted to create your bucket, since we are going to do everything in our Sydney region only, so I'm going to create the bucket also in Sydney region. Let's see whether this name is available or not. Since I said naming should be unique across the globe, irrespective of the account you are creating it. Now our bucket is created. Okay, so before that, what we do, we'll understand few things which we did not understand yesterday. We did not, you know, think get yesterday. So I'm just copying it. Going to PPT. Okay, so what I have to do, attach my key pair. Doing it. Yeah. Is it my conclusion? Okay. Fine. Now, what else? The metadata we wanted to check, right? So to check metadata, what do we do? You remember what is the, you know, little command I've given to check the metadata?
Curl, C-U-R-L.
Yes, exactly. Curl is the command needs to be used. C-U-R-L and HTTP. This is the path you please have to memorize this. HTTP colon slash slash the IP address 169.254.169.254. Of course, it's pretty easy to remember, I guess. Slash latest slash meta hyphen data. We forgot to keep, in fact, I did not take an the slash after metadata. That is the reason why we did not get any output yesterday, but today we should get. You see, this is what the metadata of our instance. So metadata contains its configuration. Metadata means configurational data. What is it? What and all its configuration is. All that is clearly mentioned in the data, that data which specifically say is metadata. So what and all you have here, you see AMI ID. What is the AMI ID we have used? AMI launch in, index, AMI manifest path, instance action, instance ID, instance type, you know, IP addresses, public IP, public keys, you know, all these things are used. If you wanted to check anything in particular, okay, use the same command. In the end, you just check. Okay, it's public IP you need to check. So just mention public IP. Okay, public hyphen IPv4. That's what is that, right? Okay. So what is the public IP of our instance? That is what the public IP of our instance. So this is how you can check. And if you wanted to redirect it to something, somewhere else, then what you have to do, you just have to use same command. And if this needs to be redirected or wanted to have this information in another separate page, then you can just, you know, have it separately. That's what, you know, a particular page, web page that's redirected. It's nothing but you are copying this or you are moving this data. I mean, like you're having a copy of this data on some other file. So you wanted to name something this as, then you can name this as my, okay, the same name you can just give. Public IP. So fine, it is copied. Okay. Now what do you do? Ls my public IP, that is the file created. Go check more, my public IP, you have this. So this is how you can just check whatever the information you wanted to check. And not only that, okay, you also can, you know, redirect it to a particular file and you can check all that details later on whenever you wanted, or you can have a copy of that in your, every time you execute this command, rather you do that, you can, you know, directly copy all this information or whichever the things you wanted to a particular file and then can have a copy of it. Okay, so that is the point. Sir, yeah.
Sir, like you copied this IP and you stored it in S3 bucket?
No. I have not stored this into S3 bucket. I am not, nowhere I have mentioned S3 bucket. Did I mention my S3 bucket name here?
No.
What is the S3 bucket name?
Where did you?
My web data 145 is the S3 bucket name we have created. But you know, when I have just redirected, I have created a file of my own choice name into the same server. In the same server, we are creating a file.
Okay.
This is the server we have, and in the same server, you are creating a file. In that file, you are copying this information, the public IP.
So this file is saved in the root volume?
Yeah, exactly, root volume.
Okay.
8 GB volume, which is assigned to this file we create instance, right? In that, it is created. Are we clear with that?
Yeah.
Fine. So this is how, this is what I wanted to show you. This is how you can check your instance metadata and what and all its configuration stuff. Okay, you wanted to check, you can just check and can have a copy of it like that. And remember, you can only check using this command, you can only check metadata, but user data cannot be checked. Okay. So user data is what? The data we manually enter while we launch an instance. So that's what user data is. Now, let us check something else. We could understand, okay, yesterday's class we have seen creating S3 bucket, deleting, I don't know whether I've shown deleting or not, but using some commands, we have Googled and checked how to create, how to deal with S3 buckets and all using command line. Do you remember? And to do that, I myself have authenticated. Okay, how did I authenticate myself? Now first let's check AWS, okay, S3 LS. You see it is saying unable to locate credentials. You can configure credentials by running AWS configure. That's what it's saying. So I have not, I don't have any permissions to access something using command line here. And to do that, what I have to do? What did we do? Yes, guys? It's suggesting me, or it's suggesting us to execute this command, of course, AWS configure. But what we have to do, what we will be doing here? Anybody? Yes. How do I authenticate myself? Access key, that's good. So we provide our access key, secret access key. Access key is like, you know, your username, and secret access key is just like your password. So by providing that, we authenticate ourselves. Yeah, that's good. Good, Srikant. Correct answer. So, I've just copied the database configure and right clicked so that it is pasted. I'm configuring it, my access ID. Okay. Every time you create a user, the user will have its access key ID and secret access key. and you know the access key can be noticed or found here after once you just go into that particular user, but you know it is not possible to get this secret access key because this is only one time. That is the reason why Amazon suggests you to download these things so that it will be downloaded into your local machine in terms of an Excel format and can use whenever you want it from that. And that Excel file should be maintained by you only and safely, so that no one gets the access to that and then you know log into some resources as you and then do something nasty. So I think I have copied that. Now secret access key. We did this already, but I just wanted to show you how is this possible without accessing or without you know configuring our credentials. That's what I wanted to show you. So I'm closing it. I don't want it to download. In the EC2 section, if you go down, the region is up till that without alphabet. The zones, availability zones will have alphabet, but regions will not. And output format, you just give none, enter. Okay. Now you execute the same command, AWS EC29 LS. You see, we have a bucket created and that bucket is mentioned here. You wanted to check what's in that bucket. Okay, AWS. Okay, now let's see. Let me just check with this on that. Then it's getting ready now. We have seen already, right? We already have seen that where our credentials will be stored. Just type ls-a is for listing all the hidden files. When you say ls-a, there will be a folder created with .aws. Okay, so go into that .aws, then check ls. Okay, it's a file credentials. So this is where you have your access key and secret access. What happens is, okay, you are now authenticating yourself as a user and trying to access things, okay, directly using Amazon's command line interface and creating whatever you wanted directly from here, from the server itself. But you know, if somebody gets these credentials, or if your instance compromises in some way, okay, and provide the access to somebody so that people get this information, access key and secret access key, so they can log into this instance as you and can do anything because they are authenticated. You are authenticated now by, you know, configuring your credentials here. So how do we safeguard that? How do we, you know, do something using Amazon's CLI without authenticating ourselves? That is possible, you know, without, when we don't want it, our credentials are to be stored in, you know, this one, our instance, we wanted a role to be attached with our instance. When a role is attached, with respect to that role, we have created and a policy is attached to that, we get the authentication directly to access. But you know, the role should be created to a particular service. What and all the services you wanted access, you wanted storage. So a policy to be attached to, you know, access storage, like we have just created S3 full access. You wanted all the other EC2 servers to be accessed, then you can just, you know, have to attach a policy with the EC2 server. So anything, any service you wanted to access, then for that, you know, you have to attach a policy and can do things here. So with respect to that role, when attached to EC2 instance, you don't need to, you know, configure your credentials here and can do your stuff directly. You can just do perform your activities without any problem, any doubt. So Amazon suggests you not to keep your credentials or not to store your credentials on any EC2 instances. Unfortunately, if they compromise with somebody or something, then your credentials are stolen by people and then can't do anything. But there is a challenge here. What is the challenge? In real time, okay, in real time, when you people get job and then, you know, start working in AWS, if you attach a role to that, everybody who has the access to the server can perform anything with respect to that role attached. So how do you track who did what? Which person has performed what activity? How do you trace that? So in order to, you know, trace, or in order to have a record of what employee is performing what activity on this server, it is not suggested to have a role attached to the instance. Okay, so what do we do now? In order to trace, you know, you must ask your users or your employees to configure their credentials so that when they are doing something, automatically when you are logging, the AWS is smart enough, the instances are smart enough to recognize your credentials. Okay, so with that, we will have a record who is performing the activities. Okay, at what time it is performed. So there will be a log created with respect to that. You can just trace if some, you know, some issues come up. AWS says not to keep any credentials, but in real time in organizations, people says that in order to trace the activity history or to have a logs created, not to, you know, attach an IAM role. But we still, you know, have to understand both these cases, how to, you know, configure our credentials or how to attach an IAM role and how it performs. Both these things should be understood by us. So let's see how, you know, we'll be able to perform all these things without, you know, configuring our credentials, but by providing, just a sec. So let's see how can we, you know, do things. Now for that, what I'll do, I'll just go launch another instance. What's happening? Yeah. Okay, we will see things later. What do we have to do? We just need to create another instance. Linux AM I'm taking. T2. So this is where an IAM role is to be attached. Okay. And remember guys, this is a question, a very important question. You can only attach a role to the instance while we create it. Once an instance is created, you can either delete the IAM roles attached to it, or you cannot add any IAM role after that. So remember, an IAM role can be attached only while creating an instance, not after it's created. Are you clear with that? But what you can do is, okay, you can change the permissions, or you can just edit the policies attached to that IAM role. So you can go here and can change the policies. Based on that policy, the permissions are to the permissions to particular service will change. So here you can edit, either you detach a policy or you wanted to add another policy. Maximum 10 policies can be attached to each role or each user or each group that we will discuss again. So you can have 10 policies attached to it. Okay, so remember, an IAM role can be attached to an instance only while it is created, not after that. What I'll say with IAM role, I'll say that's without IAM role and this is with IAM role. So let's check what is the difference. Okay, soon after we check this, we will just go create our auto scaling, but before we create auto scaling, we must need to create load balancer. So we'll understand what is what better. So till it gets ready, let's discuss what is auto scaling actually. Can somebody tell me what is auto scaling does? Before that, can somebody tell me what is ELB? Yes?
Auto-scaling will use auto-scaling for scripting.
Can you please come again? Your voice was not clear.
Okay. Auto-scaling is used for scripting.
Used for?
Scripting.
Scripting. No, any other answers? Auto-scaling uses a script but not for scripting. Anybody, any other inputs so that I can, I'll just understand from where I need to start and how I make you understand. Yes, somebody have dropped the text. Spin down instances automatically. That's correct answer by Srikanth. Anybody else, any other answer? Yes. Okay, not an issue, Sai, we'll understand that. Anybody? Okay, let me begin like this. Okay, what about ELB? What is ELB? Yeah?
Load balancer, it shuffles the servers coming responses to healthy servers.
Responses to?
Healthy servers.
What it does actually, you think responses to the healthy servers, what do you mean by response to the healthy servers? Load balancer distribute the load, Srikanth is correct. Any other answers anybody wanted to define in any other way? What we understood from load balancer? Load balance, the name itself tell you. Yes, guys.
Load balancer will allocate for if like lot of instances have been struck, so load balancers will give priority to one which is important, and it distribute according to the importance of that.
Okay, sounds good. Let's check this and come. What I wanted to check, I just wanted to check, since you know this instance has an IAM role attached to it, and then that IAM role has a policy with full permissions of S3. Okay, so now we should be able to access without you know conferring our AWS credentials. So let's check AWS S3. LS. See ya? We get it. But in the other server, you see when we have typed for the first time AWS S3-LS, it has you know given a news unable to locate credentials. Then we have you know gone to create our credentials, we have configured our credentials, and then finally in the end we could you know get the list and then do something and all with that. So when you attach an IAM role without you configure your credentials, you'll be able to do perform anything based on the policy or IAM roles permissions attached to it. Okay, and we just discussed what is the you know challenge with IAM role is attached and IAM role is not attached. Amazon says in terms of security not to keep any credentials on any instances so that no one gets the access to your instance. But in an organization in real time to have a record of or to trace who is performing and what activity is performed by a particular user or an employee, we must need to you know provide or we must need to ask the employee to configure their credentials onto the server so that we will have a log about the you know task performed by people. We're clear with that? How an instance behaves when IAM role is attached and when IAM role is not attached. We are discussing this because it is needed for us in auto-scaling when we are trying to create it. Now let's understand, okay, I hope you are clear with this, how an instance acts with instance, without instance. Are you all? Sorry, with IAM role, without IAM role?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine.
We understood.
That's good. So, yeah, good. Rest, only three inputs I'm getting, only from three people. Yeah, okay, fine. So I'm just coming out of this instance. I don't want it to use this. I'll just create some more instances separately. Okay, exit. I think we have seen an instance with the bash script, right? Bootstrap script. So we will just check that again. Now, before that, I wanted you guys to understand what is load balancer. Let's come again and understand load balancer is. Load balance, the name itself says load balances. How does it balance the load? What do you mean by load actually? Okay, what do you mean by load? You have a website, okay, for example, you have a website running and that website is accessed by people, isn't it? When people access that website, you see, what example shall I give? Since majority of the people are guys and many of the guys usually like cricket, of course, including girls also like cricket these days. So Now let me take the example of, you know, crickinfo.com, ESPN crickinfo.com. All right, is that fine? That example is fine for you, or you want me to take any other sites? I hope it's fine. So what happens, ESPN crickinfo, do we regularly log into that and check? Not really, right? So we will only log into that site when there is some cricket match going and it is something interesting. Our favorite cricketer is scoring more than, so much. Our favorite team is performing really well and we are unfortunately not in front of the TV somewhere. We are stuck with some work, or we are unfortunately had to go to our office to work that particular day. It may be a working day. So what do we do? There is no other option that we have to, you know, go check this course every time. And this has happened earlier when the god of cricket, Mr. Sachin Tendulkar, everybody loves him, of course. So when he scored 200 double knock for the first time on the planet, okay, that was a working day. I still remember, even I just checked the scores online using ESPN Cricinfo only, you know. That site was not reachable for some time. It's because since it was a working day, okay, it was a working day, everybody wanted to check the score ball by ball, because when Sachin's going to score 200, when it is, you know, the site's access, users accessing that website has increased when Sachin got closer to, you know, 200, when he has scored 180, okay, fine. Then when he scored to one, when he has reached to 190, people accessing that website increased, goes on. It was kept on, you know, increasing. Finally, the moment he just got to score his 200, by then the ESPN servers, ESPN Cricinfo website servers have gone crashed. I don't know whether you guys remember or not, but I still remember the site was not reachable for some time. I would like to give two more examples here in this case. Everybody, especially in India, when people wanted to travel using trains, they log into, Flipkart, I'll take the next one. Okay, so when they wanted to travel using trains, they usually log in IRCTC website. Okay, Indian Railway website. Every day, during normal hours, the site is quietly, comfortably reachable to everybody. Everybody can access that. But during the Tatkal time, okay, during the Tatkal ticket booking time, have you ever tried logging into that website, and are you able to log into that website quite comfortably like the normal hours? Yes, no. It's because normal time you may have some amount of users, maybe for example thousands of users. For example, I'll just take a number like 5,000 users. During Tatkal time, in that little span of time, a very limited amount of time, maybe, you know, for about 5 to 10 minutes of time, these 5,000 number which normal users access, I mean like normal, during normal hours where number of users access that website, increases to maybe 10,000 or more than that. Due to that huge amount of people accessing that website, it becomes very slow. Why it becomes very slow? When so many people access that website, where is that website created? Obviously the website is created on a server, right? On a computer. You have a computer, you build website onto that by building, first web server is created, Apache is built on that, and after once Apache is built on that, you have to create a web server. Okay, you need to create a website. That website is nothing but its combination of all the HTML pages. And when people are trying to access that, you know, obviously the server will feel huge amount of load. How many servers it needs to access, how many people, you know, get the access. Okay, I would like to give, due to that, such a huge load, you know, experiencing by this server, it will become so slow in, you know, accessing or in serving all those people's requests. And another example with Flipkart. When Flipkart has announced its big day sale for the first time, even Flipkart servers have also gone crashed. Nobody could access the Flipkart, you know, a site maybe for a couple of hours or a day, because Flipkart did not notice or did not estimate how many users will hit their website, okay, without having any estimation, without having these cloud concepts. They did not, you know, plan a proper infrastructure. So the servers they then had could not bear such a huge amount of load. So they became, you know, they have gone crashed. And one more thing I would like to tell you. Okay. What to say? Your computer, your normal computer. Just check. A computer with 1 GB of RAM and a computer with 4 GB of RAM. You have two computers, or you two friends are sitting together. Either of you have a computer with 1 GB RAM and the other person has a computer with 4 GB RAM. And you are trying to access something in that computer. Which system works faster? Alright? The computer with 1 GB?
No, more GB RAM.
Obviously the computer with 4 GB RAM function faster, yeah. Right? Works faster. You'll be able to access, yes, everything very fast. Isn't it? So it's because the memory it is having and the capacity it is having, it will, you know, provide a faster. So the same thing, the same way, when number of people requesting are hitting your website, which means that is load. And in order to serve such a huge load, what you have to do, you need to expand your number of servers. How do you expand your number of servers? You have to, you know, create another server which is identical to the existing one, with all, you know, similar to the configurational stuff and all the applications, and including the website created into that. Same website should be created into that. Then in that case, okay, in that case, rather you have a one server, you know, addressing all such requests. You have multiple servers requesting to all, you know, serving all such requests. Then automatically your environment will be fast enough and will be able to serve all the requests, or will be able to, you know, meet up, reach out the requirement, any number of people access that website. But okay, I have, for example, three servers in my, you know, in my environment for my live production, and all the three servers have got same configuration, same website created onto that, because I have only one website. I'm just doing the business with that website, and I wanted people to access that. When I have three servers, okay, when I have three servers with the same website created, and when people are trying to access that website, how these requests understand which server is free and to which server these requests are to be sent? If they do not understand this, all the requests are sent to one server only, what is the purpose of having three servers? Does that make sense? You getting any idea what I'm talking about? Yes, guys? I'm saying we have three servers, but all the requests are routed to one particular server only. The other two servers are being unused, idle. So is there any sense that we have three servers, having three servers for our environment? Yes, guys? Yeah? No, right. So obviously, when one server is having all the addressing all the requests, you know, the same thing, the site will still behave the same way. That slow, it goes very slow, it will be accessed by people very slow. Or when request goes on, request increases, then it may, the server may go crash again. So in order to, you know, in order to address all these requests to all the servers available in your environment, okay, I have three servers. When people are requesting my website or accessing my website, then in that situation, I wanted a mechanism which needs to route all these requests to all the three servers equally in order to burden any one particular server. When it route all the three different servers, that's really beautiful, right? That's really comfortable. So all the three servers share the load so that the load is balanced with all the three servers, and your site is quite comfortable for the people to access it, and you are reaching out to the requirement. You clear with that? Yes. So what does this load is distributed or routed to all these three servers equally? Which mechanism does here in our AWS cloud? Yes? Load balancer, of course. So load balancer does that. So what we do when we create multiple servers, first we create a load balancer, okay? And to that load balancer, we attach all of our servers which are healthy and ready to, you know, accept these requests and meet up the requirement. So this load balancer is really very smart enough that it distribute. What load balancer does? I wanted you to tell me this particular statement when I ask next time. Load balancer distribute the load to all the healthy instances. Okay, all the healthy and available instances in our environment. Are we clear with that? Load balancer distribute all the load hitting to our website or hitting to our servers to all the healthy and available instances. So, are you clear, guys? What is ELB? What is load balancer? It's of course parallelly. Yeah.
It distributes all the load coming hitting to the website to all the servers equally.
All the servers available and healthy. All the servers
healthy.
They are not only available, but they should be healthy. That's what we have seen in load balancer, right? We have created a load balancer, and in that we have created a healthcheck.html page so that the load balancer continuously ping each server to that web page healthcheck.html and confirm by itself whether the server is healthy or not, so that it can send the traffic to that or not. If the server is healthy, it will send the traffic. If not, it will treat that server as unhealthy, but still it will keep pinging to that whether it become alive or not, whether it become healthy or not. So that is what the point. Now when it, you know, confirm by itself that the server has become healthy again, then it will start sending traffic to that. That is what load balancer does. Now my question is, understand this question and you should answer to me. My question is, of course I have three servers, okay? I have three servers, and these three servers are still not being able to enough, okay, are not enough or not being able to reach the purpose, or not able to meet up the requirement, or the load is still increasing more and more and more, whereas these three servers are fully occupied and may not be able to bear such a huge load. In this situation, what are we supposed to do? Are you clear with my question? You want me to repeat that question again? If you are clear, you please tell me what are we supposed to do? Adding additional instances. Okay, that's a good answer. Adding additional servers using auto scaling. That's even more good answer. Another server. Okay. Okay, fine. That's fantastic. We need to add few more servers to the environment. Okay, we need to add few more servers to the instances. Imagine if we need to add servers to the environment physically, is that possible to add within no time just like our cloud? Yes. Imagine you have a big day sale in your website, the servers load is increasing and you wanted to create some servers physically. Will you be able to, you know, create some servers physically just like that and then attach it to the environment before your big day sale is completed?
No, we will be another work busy. So.
Will be?
We may be in other work
or we may have some admin, you know, monitor this load and then appoint somebody to create servers. But in physical, you know, in physical scenario, okay, creating a server takes really a lot of time, at least a session, couple of hours of time. You know, you need to get the hardware, fix it, then install OS into that, install applications, install, you know, create a web server, then, you know, add all your web pages into that, then your website is ready. After that, you need to test whether your website is working fine or not. After once that is done, then you consider that server is as a live server or considered to be ready for your live production. So to do all these things, how much time it takes? It probably take, you know, at least half a day time to do all this stuff. But in cloud, okay, by the time in physical scenario when you create, by that time your big day sale may complete or your servers may go crash. So we wanted one mechanism, again like load balancer, which can spin up the instances just like that in a matter of no time and attach to our load balancer so that they share that huge load from the, you know, from the existing three servers and make them comfortable, those three servers comfortable, and also reach all your customers and serve the need. That's comfortable, right? So what will perform? What will perform this activity? Which mechanism perform this activity, creating or spinning up instances within no time and attaching to the load balancer? Auto scaling. That's good. So auto scaling. Now, did you get the concept why auto scaling is used?
Yeah, to increase the instances automatically when the servers are too heavy.
Servers load is too heavy, yes. So when servers load is too heavy, auto scaling automatically spin up the instances, and not only that, it not only spin up the instances but also spin down the instances when the servers are being idle. Okay, you have started your big day sale in the morning 10 o'clock, that's 10 a.m. just a sec. Give me a second. Sorry guys, sorry for that break. So it's not what I'm talking. Okay, auto scaling not only spin up the instances but also spin down the instances. Okay, so that's what I'm talking about. Look, like 10 o'clock in the morning, you have started your big day sale and it has completed around 6 p.m. in the evening. Okay, so after that, you know, after that, the newly spinned up servers, apart from your three servers which you have dedicatedly assigned for your environment, will become idle, right? So why do you pay unnecessarily keeping them in your environment, isn't it? When a server is created, obviously you're paying. So why do we need to pay unnecessarily? So in order to not to pay, we terminate them. So rather we do manually, we assign the same work to auto scaling only. So auto scaling can also spin down these instances. But how does this auto scaling get to know when to spin up the instances and when to spin down the instances? First of all, auto scaling should be notified that the load is increasing so much, right? Are we clear with this? Auto scaling just cannot spin up the instances and spin down instances just like that on the fly, right? Spinning up instances is nothing but creating instance. Okay, so understand in that way. Spin up the instance means creating the instances. Spin down the instances is nothing but terminate the instance. Deleting the instances, creating, deleting the servers. So how does this auto scaling understand when to create the servers or when to delete the servers? For that, what do? We take the help of CloudWatch alarms concept. Did you remember we have created an alarm in day before yesterday's class? Yeah. Yesterday's class. So in that alarm, we had three different actions to be performed. One is actions on EC2, and the other one is SNS notifications, sending notifications, and third one is auto scaling. Remember? So that alarms will be created in between. And where do these alarms created? The alarms created will be in kept in between load balancer and auto scaling. So what load balancer does? Load balancer not only distribute the load to all the healthy instances, but also when servers are experiencing huge amount of load, it will notify auto scaling saying that my servers are experiencing huge amount of load and there is so much of load hitting to our website, it's increasing. So auto scaling, you please spin up the instances, which means you please create the instances. That's how it will notify auto scaling. The ELB notify auto scaling with respect to the alarms. Then with respect to the commands received from a load balancer, auto scaling react and spin up the instances. You clear with that? And these alarms can be created in multiple ways. Like how do you say, what way you said that? When you wanted to spin up the instances, you just set an alarm saying that whenever my CPU, my server's CPU utilization increases more than 90% or more than 80%, then automatically ELB should notify auto scaling and auto scaling should spin up the instances. The moment it receives the command saying, okay, my server's CPU utilization is reaching more than 80%, then when does it spin up the instances? You can also set another alarm saying, whenever my instances CPU is lesser than or equals to 20% or 10% or 15%, whatever it is, then it needs to spin up that instances whichever is having less load or almost idle. isn't it?
So, sir.
Yeah, yeah.
Can we keep a multiple alarms to one instance?
Yes, not one instance, one auto scaling group.
One auto scaling group? Okay, yeah, okay.
Here we are not talking about instances, dear. We are not talking about instances, we are talking about auto scaling and load balancer. These two together function properly, communicating each other. Load balancer tell auto scaling, saying, okay, the load is increasing, you spin up the instance. How will it notify? It will notify auto scaling, load balancer notify auto scaling, saying that my server's load is increasing and its CPU utilization is going more than 90%. So the moment it receives that command, it will spin up the instance. Then again, load balancer say that my CPU utilization, my server CPU utilization is now lesser than what it says, say 20%. Then the moment it receives the command, okay, so the servers are idle, now we can terminate them. Okay, so this is how auto scaling work with respect to load balancer. Are we clear with that? Yes?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. So, I think Shilpa is already left. Yes. What about you guys? Are you ready so that we just go and see something practically, or we conclude? Because once we start, it will probably take minimum of 30 minutes. So we need to complete it, understanding every single parameter. We'll continue. Okay, one say yes, one say no. Drop your inputs here. We'll conclude it for today and start the hands-on of auto scaling tomorrow, or go ahead and do that. Anything is fine, anything is fine. To continue, one no. So what do I understand with these multiple responses? What is to be performed? I'm just thinking about, since auto scaling work with load balancer, we first have to create a load balancer, okay, and have to create an auto scaling group. Before we create auto scaling group, we must have to create launch configurations. So launch configuration is something like creating an EC2 instance. Okay, after once that is done, then we go create auto scaling group. And apart from these things, you know, we also have to prepare the bash script. And two people are missing in the class, of course. Anu is missing, and it's an important thing. I wanted everybody. Okay, if you guys say yes with me, I have something in my mind, like, since two guys are not in the class today and one guy is saying conclude and two guys are saying anything is fine, what I'm thinking is we will do this directly lab. We'll start lab directly in tomorrow's class from this crash of auto scaling and load balancer. It will be like creating a high available environment, HA. So it will be like a project to you. I will show you every single parameter, explaining everything in detail. And in the end, that will be like a project that you have to create auto scaling with respect to load balancer, like a high availability environment, and submit it to me with the screenshots in the WhatsApp. Will that be okay for you? Yes? Okay. Fine. So what do we do? Tomorrow we will log in. The moment we will log in, we will start, you know, creating all these things. Of course, I will discuss everything in detail while we create what things you need to set, what options you have to take. Okay, so all those things will be discussed. But for now, you just have an understanding in your mind what is auto-scaling, what is load balancer, how these two things work for a proper and healthy environment. Okay, are we clear with that? Okay, fine. So for today, the assignment for you is launch an instance with IAMrole and another instance without IAMrole. I want you to perform creating a, you know, what it says, S3 bucket, and I wanted you to send those screenshots to me. That is your activity or your task for today. I wanted everybody to perform that and share your screens once after you perform or while you practice it, so that I understand you have done something, and any doubt you get, you come across, that can be discussed in the group chat or in the class directly. Okay. So from today onwards, every day we will do like this. In the end, a task is given to you, and that is to be performed by you people without fail, and then screens are to be shared with me so that we will understand what it is, and you will also be clear with the topics. Okay guys, then hope you will do that task, perform, and also check your instance metadata. Okay, and those who have not performed ELB, please perform that also. ELB also, you please practice. So tomorrow while we create ELB, you will understand even more clearly and then have no doubt. Yes, fine. Then if everything is fine, I'll just conclude our class for today. Catch you tomorrow in the morning. Okay, fine then. Chalo, good day. Bye.